Dr. Joe Dispenza é autor best-seller do New York Times, pesquisador, conferencista e consultor corporativo. Ele realiza uma brilhante interface entre ciência e espiritualidade, integrando com maestria os conhecimentos da física quântica, neurociência e epigenética para explorar a ciência por trás das remissões espontâneas. Ele usa esse conhecimento para ensinar as pessoas a curar seus corpos de problemas de saúde, fazer mudanças significativas em suas vidas e desenvolver sua consciência. Desde 2010, ele está com uma equipe de cientistas para pesquisar os efeitos da meditação no coração e nas funções cerebrais, na resposta imunológica e na saúde geral da mente e do corpo. Dr. Joe, é um imenso prazer apresentar o seu trabalho para o público brasileiro, especialmente aos meus seguidores, que já viram falar de você muitas vezes. É uma honra e uma alegria poder entrevistá-lo e possibilitar que mais pessoas tenham acesso a conhecimentos tão transformadores. Eu acompanho o seu trabalho desde 2005, no filme Quem Somos Nós, e sempre esse trabalho foi uma grande fonte de inspiração para mim. Eu já participei de 3 eventos com você, 2 lá no Congresso Mundial de Medicina Quântica na Bahia, 1 na Califórnia, né? O workshop progressivo que eu fiz com você, e espero ainda fazer o seu retiro mais longo. Em toda a sua incrível obra, né? E o seu último livro, Como Tornar-se Sobrenatural, que está sendo lançado agora no Brasil, você compartilha a possibilidade não só de se autocurar e de criar conscientemente novas oportunidades, mas também de viver experiências místicas e transcendentais. Portanto, quero deixar aqui a minha imensa gratidão de ter você conosco, poder apresentar esse seu trabalho para o público brasileiro. Nós possamos tocar mentes e corações de pessoas no Brasil e no mundo.
Ah, it's a pleasure to be with you, Wallace.
Nice. Let's go to the first question. No seu livro Quebrando o Hábito de Ser Você Mesmo, você fala como a personalidade é criada e como vivemos comumente no passado, revivendo as experiências emocionais que nos proporcionaram qualquer tipo de ameaça à nossa sobrevivência. Gostaria que você falasse como a nossa personalidade é criada e como podemos reeducar o nosso corpo-mente e transformar uma personalidade doentia e pessimista numa personalidade saudável e otimista.
Ah, a great question, Wallace. Well, one of the foundational principles of the work that we teach, independent of your belief system, whether you're into spirituality, whether you're into psychology, whether you're into being an entrepreneur, the principle is the same, and that is that your personality has a direct effect on your personal reality. And your personality is made up of how you think, how you act, and how you feel. So the present personality who's listening to this presentation has created the present personal reality called their life, which means if you wanted to change your life, if you wanted to change your personal reality, you're going to have to change. You're going to have to change your personality. So there's an economy of action in our biology that says that if you keep thinking the same way, doing the same things, react emotionally the same way, the body tends to economize how we store information. So if we think 60 to 70,000 thoughts in one day, and 90% of those thoughts are the same thoughts as the day before, and you believe that your thoughts have something to do with your destiny, as long as you're thinking in the same way, it makes sense that your life is going to stay the same. So then the same thoughts always lead to the same choices. The same choices always lead to the same behaviors. The same behaviors create the same experiences, and the same experiences produce the same emotions, and those same emotions begin to influence our very same thoughts. Now the catch is that our biology, our neurocircuitry, our neurochemistry, our hormones, and even our gene expression is equal to how we think, how we act, and how we feel. So the principle of economy says that nerve cells that fire together will wire together. So by thinking the same way, making the same choices, performing the same behaviors, creating the same experiences that lead to the same emotions that reaffirm the feeling that's familiar to you, and you do that 5 to 10 years ongoing, you begin to hardwire your brain into a very finite signature. Now, that finite signature is a level of mind, because mind is the brain in action. So then we're reminding ourselves who we are based on how we think, how we act, and how we feel. You do that enough times, then it all of a sudden becomes like a computer program. And our personality, by the time we're 35 years old, becomes a set of memorized behaviors, automatic habits, unconscious emotional reactions, hardwired beliefs, perceptions, attitudes that function just like a computer program, which means you press start and it runs automatically. So most people's behaviors, most people's thoughts, most people's emotional reactions, they've done so many times that they no longer are conscious that they're doing them. So 95% of who we are by the time we're 35 years old is a set of unconscious states of mind and body. So then crisis, trauma, disease, diagnosis, loss causes a person to finally stop the programs and ask themselves an important question. Do I want to stay this way or do I want to change? Now, the moment we're feeling so unhappy that we're no longer returning our emails or posting on Facebook or Instagram, we're no longer texting back to people, we're no longer showing up for dinner and seeing the same people and doing the same things. When we reach that point in our life where we no longer feel the same way and nothing in our life is making that feeling go away, this is that moment of awakening where the person starts to look and observe and think about what they're thinking about. They start becoming aware and conscious of how they act, how they speak. They notice that the feeling that they've been living by for the last 25 years is guilt, but they didn't know it was guilt because it feels like how they always feel. Now, the moment they can observe those states of mind and body and they become conscious of it, they're no longer unconscious, which means they're no longer in the program. They're consciousness observing their unconscious self, and that's the first step to change. In fact, the word meditation means to become familiar with. So as you become familiar with those hardwired thoughts, automatic habituations, reflexive emotional reactions, when you become so conscious of those unconscious states of mind and body, that you won't go unconscious to your old personality self in your waking day. Now you're out of the bleachers and you're on the playing field. Now the game has begun. So then most people try to change their personality with the 5% of their conscious mind that's working against 95% of what they've programmed subconsciously. And meditation is a way that we use to begin to regulate brainwaves, teach people a formula on how to slow down their conscious mind, open the door between the conscious mind and the subconscious mind, get beyond the analytical mind, and then rewrite the program to change some subconscious state of mind and body so that now they're no longer unconsciously sabotaging themselves and their lives.
Nice, great. Dr. Joe, os nossos pensamentos, emoções, sentimentos e estilo de vida nos levam a expressar os genes da saúde ou da doença, do estresse ou da autoconsciência. Você já pensou numa educação voltada para educar os nossos genes? Seria tipo, um tipo de escola epigenética para a evolução da consciência?
Well, I hope on some level, Wallace, that I'm actually making a difference. Yes. In people's lives. And the message is such an important message in this timely period in humanity, that in fact, we are not hardwired to be a certain way for the rest of our lives. We're not doomed by our genes because our father was an alcoholic or our mother was depressed. We are marvels of adaptability and change. But teaching people the understanding about who they really are from a biological standpoint begins to give people a sense of empowerment. So then we've done research studies to show that if you begin to think differently, if you begin to make different choices, if you begin to do different things, if you can create a new experience, if you can feel a new emotion that is not anger, It's not aggression. It's not fear. It's not anxiety. It's not guilt. It's not shame. It's not unworthiness. But you begin to train yourself to elevate your emotional state. Now think about this. It will produce dramatic effects in your gene expression because you're no longer thinking, acting, and feeling the same way. And so when you study the history of genes and you're studying rodents in an unchanging environment, if there's no environmental stimulation that's anything diverse or different, then the rodent is headed for genetic destiny because there's no new information coming in that causes them to change their gene expression. Now, epigenetics says genes don't create disease. In fact, if you look at the research, between 5% and 1% of the people on the planet are born with a genetic disorder, like type 1 diabetes, sickle cell anemia, Tay-Sachs disease. The other 95 to 99% is created by lifestyle. Now think about this. You can take two identical twins, have the exact same genome. One of them dies at 82 and the other one dies at 51. Exact same genes, but what happened was they interpreted or had different experiences in the environment. Now, the end product of an experience in the environment is called an emotion. So then if people live by the same emotions every single day, they're keeping the same genes expressing and other genes that are turned off. And it's the hormones of stress, the survival chemicals that switch on the emergency system in the body that taps the body of all its resources for some threat in the outer environment. Short term, that's fine. But long term, you keep that stress response going for an extended period of time. No organism can live in emergency mode for that long because you're tapping all the body's vital resources for some threat in the outer world, real or imagined, and no energy in our inner world for growth and repair, for long-term building projects. So then, just by pure supply and demand, when people don't know how to control their emotional reactions to the problems and conditions in their environment, then on some level, they're victims to their environment. And you say, Wallace, why are you upset today? What's bothering you? You say, oh, this person or this circumstance in my life is causing me to feel this way. What you're really saying is that something in my environment is actually influencing my free will to feel and think a certain way. So if anything in your environment is controlling your feelings and thoughts, or at least you think it is, then you're a victim to your environment, which means then you will be more prone to effects that take place from your environment to weaken the organism. Now, people don't know that they do this. This is an unconscious process. My message is, if you can change the way you think and feel, and how you think and how you feel creates your state of being, because thoughts are the vocabulary of the brain and feelings are the vocabulary of your body. And how you think and feel is your state of being. So then most people wake up in the morning, they remember their problems. Their problems are memories that are etched in their brain that are connected to certain people and objects, certain times and places. The moment they think about their problems, they're thinking in the past. And because every experience or problem they've had in their life has an emotion associated with it, the moment they feel unhappy, now their body's in the past. So then if the emotions are influencing their thoughts and those thoughts are producing the same chemicals for feel the same emotions, then they're in a familiar state of being. And most people start their day reaffirming the feelings of their problems that they identify with that become their identity. So then they wake up and then they go through a series of routine behaviors and they brush their teeth. They go to work, they drive, do the work, they go to work, they do the same things, they see the same people, they eat the same food, they watch the same television shows. And now they're programming their body to be in a predictable future because it's the same thing they did yesterday. And now they've lost their free will to a series of programs. And a habit is a redundant set of automatic, unconscious thoughts, behaviors, and emotions that's acquired through repetition. A habit is when you've done something so many times that your body now knows how to do it better than your conscious mind. So what's the relevance behind that? Now the person has lost their free will to a set of programs and their body's dragging them into the same future based on what they did in the past. So the familiar past and the predictable future become the known. And teaching people how to create from the unknown means they would have to finally get into the present moment and dissociate from everything known in their life in order to create something new. So then, yes, we are not doomed by our genes. Those people in 4 days at one event, doing different things, thinking differently, making different choices, having different experiences, feeling different emotions, they turned on collectively as a group of 32 people. We saw that they all switched on certain genes, but collectively, they all activated 8 genes that they had in common. The genes for growing new neurons in your brain, to reduce oxidative stress, to strengthen your immune system, to create stem cells to go to damaged tissues and repair them. These are all regenerative functions when a person begins to teach their body what it feels like to live in a future reality that hasn't happened yet emotionally. So if the environment signals the gene, that's epigenetics, and the end product of an experience in the environment is an emotion, if you can embrace an emotion ahead of the actual experience, you're signaling genes ahead of the environment, and your body begins to biologically change. That means you can't wait for your healing to feel gratitude. You can't wait for your new relationship to feel love. That's cause and effect. We want to cause an effect. So as we teach our body what it feels like emotionally ahead of the experience, you could actually reprogram your gene expression. And the side effect of that is the person starts to notice changes in their health. But they're not visualizing their cancer going away. They're just becoming somebody else. They're embracing the emotions of their future. They're thinking equal to those emotions, and they're changing their state of being.
Nice, great. No seu livro, Como Se Tornar Sobrenatural, você revela belas experiências místicas e afirma que tornar-se sobrenatural envolve abraçar uma maior consciência de si mesmo e de quem você é no mundo. Como é que você definiria uma educação voltada para a autoconsciência e para o propósito de sermos parceiros do universo na sua evolução e sermos assim também naturalmente sobre-humanos e incorporarmos os milagres na nossa vida cotidiana?
Yeah, I think that I'll answer that question in two ways. First is, I have been privileged enough to have unusual mystical experiences throughout my entire life, that most of which I've never really shared with anybody. But those mystical moments where I was transcendent of who I thought I was. I had an experience of myself that was other than me, and yet it was more real than the physical reality that I live in. And it was something that I was interested in. I couldn't find a lot of data and research that proved its existence, but there's really 4 states of consciousness. There's wakefulness, there's sleep, there's dreaming, and then there's the transcendental moment. And so when I started to look at the biological systems that could be influential in creating the mystical experience, I had to dig very deeply into the scientific research, empirical research, to see if there were latent systems in the brain and body that, once activated, can cause us to go from an experience of a physical body local in space and time and 3-dimensional reality to an experience of myself outside of space and time. And so in Becoming Supernatural, I do my best to explain that once these latent systems are activated, a person can begin to interact with a field of information, frequency, that carries information that has nothing to do with information that you're getting from your senses. In other words, you and I are sitting here talking. I'm looking at you. My eyes see Wallace. I remember you from Quantum University when I met you the first time. I am listening to what you're saying. I'm sitting in my chair. I'm smelling. My body is gathering information from the environment. But when you teach a person how to change their brainwaves, to begin to slow down their analytical mind, their thinking brain, and they know how to self-regulate and create more order and coherence in their brain, if they do this properly, as I said earlier, they begin to open a portal between the conscious mind and the subconscious mind. And when they do this and get adept at it, they'll do even better in slowing down the memory bank of the known self that connects them to information in three-dimensional reality. In other words, your thinking neocortex is what plugs you into reality. So then we now know, based on the research we've done, is that when people begin to slow down the brainwaves in their thinking neocortex, if they can get into this very slow brainwave state called theta, that's a very hypnotic state. That's when you're suggestible to information. It's what a hypnotist does. It slows a person's brainwaves down by relaxing them, and then they plant suggestions in their subconscious, and then they can't consciously remember it because it's planted subconsciously, but they're influenced to do certain things. Well, don't think that when you watch TV that you're not being programmed by information because your brain is in a state of trance. So then, what if your eyes are closed, there's music playing in the background, you're sitting still, you're not eating, so you're not tasting, you're not smelling, you're not feeling and experiencing, so you're not moving around, and you're able to dial down the activity in the neocortex, and then you teach people how to become connected to frequency that's carrying information. And if the latent system in the brain is activated, then like a transducer, like a radio or TV antenna, it can take a frequency and scramble it into, or descramble it into a profound visual image, like a television screen. That's exactly what the pineal gland in the back of the brain does. It has tiny little crystals in it that are stacked on top of each other that, once activated, begin to tune into frequency and information. So teaching a person how to disconnect from their environment, to disconnect from their body, to no longer be preoccupied with time, and move into that generous present moment, the eternal now, and teach them how to tune into frequencies that are carrying information, that once that system is activated, the pineal gland will cause an effect in the brain that causes the person to have a full-on sensory experience without ever using their senses. In other words, they're sitting there, and what's going on between their ears is more real than anything they've ever experienced in their entire life. So then that full-on sensory experience, imagine if your senses were heightened right now by 40%, everything you were seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, feeling. If your senses were heightened, your awareness of everything in your environment would be heightened. And awareness is consciousness, and you can't have consciousness without energy. So when we see a person having a transcendental moment, there's an incredible release of energy that takes place in the brain that is so outside of normal that when we show it to the scientific community, the first thought that they have is they think the person's having a stroke, but it's not a stroke because it's too coherent, it's too orderly, it's too fast of a frequency. This person is interacting with energy, and it's causing a very profound experience right in their brain. And so when they come back to their senses, that experience has changed them on a fundamental level, and the change is not happening from anything out there in their three-dimensional reality. It happens in here, and the feeling from that arousal isn't the like stress, like anger or aggression. It's not fear and anxiety. It's not pain. It's ecstasy. It's bliss. It is a transcendental feeling that causes you to feel connected to something even greater. And since experience enriches the brain, and it does, and experience produces a signal to the body called an emotion, that person's inner event has changed them on a very, very profound level. It's reorganized the circuitry, that's what experience does, and the signal going to the body is less chemical, it's more electric. And the person then, as a side effect of their interaction with this mystical divine intelligence, gets a biological upgrade. In other words, there goes their psoriasis, there goes their deafness, there goes their blindness, there goes their Parkinson's disease, there goes their stage 4 cancer. Now, energy is influencing matter. And the person has learned how to get suggestible to information, but not through their senses, by becoming suggestible to information and tuning into frequencies, coherent frequencies that carry information. It's like having a Wi-Fi signal. There's a resonance that takes place, and the brain is prepared for that experience. And so we've narrowed it down to a formula of coherence in the brain and coherence in the heart. And when we do that properly, we have a very strong, very powerful Wi-Fi signal.
Very nice. Great. Dr. Joe, você fala muito da importância da gratidão no processo de manifestação de uma nova realidade. Como é que acontece esse processo internamente?
Well, this is a reconditioning that has to take place in the sincere person that wants to learn how to create from the field instead of from matter. Let's see if I can break this down simply. When you receive something favorable, or you just receive something favorable, if something just happened to you that you liked, or something unexpected to you is happening to you in the present moment, the emotion that you feel is gratitude. So the emotional signature of gratitude means something just happened that you liked, or something is happening to you right in that moment. So the emotional signature of gratitude is the emotional signature of receiving. Now, thoughts are electrical charges in the quantum field, and feelings are like magnetic charges in the quantum field. And how you think and how you feel creates your state of being. So the thought sends the signal out, and the feeling draws the event back. And the heart tends to be the magnet that draws experiences to us. So if the person is intending to be healthy, intending to be wealthy, intending to be in love in a new relationship, but they're sending the signal out, and they're waiting for the environment to produce the event so they can feel the emotion, then they're hypnotized and conditioned into believing they need a reason for gratitude. They need a reason to feel love. They need a reason to feel abundant. That's waiting for the environment to change so that you can feel the emotion, to give you the relief from the separation of the experience. But if it requires a coherent brain, that's the thought sending the signal out, and a coherent heart, that means drawing the event back to you, then what emotion do people typically feel in their waking day? They feel fear, they feel anxiety, they feel aggression, unworthiness, insecurity, competition, guilt, shame, unworthiness, whatever it is. So they don't have a Wi-Fi signal. And when the heart feels aggression, when the heart feels frustration, when we feel impatience, the heart beats out of order. It's very incoherent. When we feel gratitude, when we feel appreciation, when we feel love, the heart beats very orderly, and you can teach people how to do that. And when the heart beats orderly, it begins to produce an ambient external magnetic field that's up to 3 meters wide. Now your heart is in order, and it's sending a strong signal out, and that's energy. And that energy is frequency, and frequency carries information. And now you can lay the thought of your health on the frequency because it's a match. You can't lay health on the thought of suffering or the feeling of suffering. It doesn't work. The feeling of suffering carries different thoughts. So then teaching people how to create that kind of coherence in their heart, well, we're not asking them to pretend to do it. We're asking them, we put heart rate monitors on them, and we can tell you whether you're doing it or not, because we want you to see that when you do this properly, when you're feeling the feelings of gratitude for your creations before they happen, your body is so objective that it does not know the difference between the real life experience that's producing the emotion and the emotion that you're creating by thought alone. To the body, it's believing that it's living in that future reality in the present moment. And if you're feeling gratitude for your creations, you're less likely to look for them because you don't feel separate from them. You feel connected to them. Now, if you lose that feeling of your connection energetically to your future and you start feeling hostile or impatient, you just return back to the emotions that are familiar to you that are of your past. And now you disconnected from the energy of your future. And if you say to me, well, it's because of my ex or because of my boss or because of my coworker, or because of the news or because of the traffic, and I would say to you, oh no, you're back to the unconscious program of believing that you're a victim to your life. So then when a person combines that clear intention, a vision of their future, combined with an elevated emotion, the stronger the emotion that they could feel in a sense of gratitude, the more altered they feel inside of them, the more they'll pay attention to the intention in their mind. And now they're branding that image holographically in their brain, and in a sense, they're remembering their future and they're changing their state of being. So then our job then is to be able to maintain this energetic state for our entire day. And if you can, and you can stay coherent, get ready, because weird things are going to begin to happen to you in your life. You're going to start seeing feedback coming to you because you're the magnet to your destiny. Now you don't have to go get anything and drag your body through space and force and control outcomes and fight for them. That's what matter does when it's trying to affect matter. But when you're creating from the field and you have a Wi-Fi signal and you have, there's a vibrational match between your energy and some possibility in the quantum field, and those synchronicities and those opportunities and those coincidences that are happening all around you, you're not doing anything. You change your energy, you change your life, and being able to sustain that for an extended period of time until you see feedback in your life is the sign then that you're the creator of your life. And when those incidents occur and you feel the excitement and the joy and the awe from the fact that it appeared right in front of you, I guarantee you that that feeling you're going to use for your next creation. And it's going to be a little easier for you to feel gratitude. It's going to be a little easier for you to fall in love with life. And what I love about our community of students around the globe, Wallace, is that our students do the work. They're not philosophers. They show up and they do it every day, not because they have to, but because there's magic happening in their life. And they don't want that magic to end. And so they want to continuously prove to themselves that they're, how they think and feel is producing outcomes in their life, that they're the creator of their life. And all of a sudden, they believe less that they're the victim of their life. And they're more paying attention now to how they're feeling. They're more aware of how they're thinking. They're catching themselves and returning back to that same energy. I do it 50 to 100 times a day, just keep making my way back to that same state. And how many times do we have to become conscious to the point where we no longer go unconscious? And that's the moment we change.
Very nice. Let's go to the next question. Dr. Joe, com os índices alarmantes de depressão e ansiedade, além de outras doenças crônicas e autoimunes, vivemos numa cultura em que aprendemos muito bem como adoecer. Como criar uma metodologia de forma reversa que nos faz adoecer para promover a saúde?
Well, I love this question because it's something that I've studied for the last 20 years easily. It's very simple. It's a scientific fact that the long-term effects of the hormones of stress down-regulate genes and create disease. It's a fact that nobody could live in emergency mode for an extended period of time. Now, there's three types of stress. There's physical stress, like trauma, accidents, injuries. There's chemical stress, like toxins, pesticides, pollutants, viruses, bacteria, blood sugar levels, whatever. And there's emotional stress, psychological stress, family tragedies, single parenting, second mortgages, investments, finances. The problem is that most stress ends up as psychological or emotional stress. In fact, In the Western world, 75 to 90% of every person that walks into a healthcare facility in the Western world walks in because of psychological or emotional stress. That means somewhere between 7.5 and 9 people out of 10 are showing up at their doctor's office because emotional stress is keeping their body out of balance, out of homeostasis. And stress is when your body is knocked out of balance and knocked out of order. So when you perceive a threat or a danger, you have the feeling that something's gonna go bad or wrong, you switch on that primitive nervous system called the fight or flight nervous system, and your body's physiology is moved out of balance. Your pupils dilate, your heart rate increases, respiratory rate increases, you're mobilizing enormous amount of glucose, the adrenal glands switch on, digestive juices shut down, blood sent to the extremities. Now you're ready to do one of three things: run, fight, or hide. Now, the research says that people spend, on the average, 70% of the time in this state. That means then that they're so aroused and prepared for the worst thing that could happen in their life that they keep the stress response going for an extended period of time. Now, when you turn on the stress response and you can't turn it off, now you're headed for disease. So most diseases that are created from lifestyle, as we talked about with genetics, are because of the mismanagement of people's emotions and their attention. And the stronger the emotions we feel for some problem or condition in our life, the more we put our attention on it. And where you place your attention is where you place your energy. So much people's attention and energy is placed on their outer environment because that's where the danger is. So the arousal of those hormones gives the body a rush of adrenaline. And like a drug addict, people go on addictions to these stress hormones. They have a bad trip. They can't stop the addiction. And so they use the problems and the conditions in their life to reaffirm their addiction to some emotion, whether it's the ex, whether it's the coworker, whether it's the boss, whether it's the news. They need something to keep them aroused to reaffirm their emotional state. Now, because of the neocortex, the size of the neocortex in human beings, it's interesting because our problems become more complex. When we react to our mother-in-law or we react to some traffic or whatever, and it's not a predator or some danger, we're turning on that stress response because of some past experience. But then we can think about our problems and turn on the stress response by thought alone. So if the emotions of stress tend to be addictive, and you can turn on that stress response by thought alone, people become addicted to their own thoughts. And if the stress response long-term pushes the genetic buttons that create disease, and you can turn on the stress response just by thought alone, then your thoughts are going to make you sick. So then, just like an addict that has to break the addiction of some substance that they're dependent on, in order for us to truly change, then, if we're using the people and problems in our life to reaffirm our addiction, that means we're addicted to the life we don't even like. And so people would rather cling to the familiar than take a chance and possibility, because once they take a chance and possibility, they move into the unknown. And when you move into the unknown, you can't predict your future. That's what the unknown is about, but that is the perfect place to create from. So then the person who's had a traumatic event when they were 25 years old and now they're 45. And that person had an event that branded them emotionally, and the stronger the emotion they had from that event, the more they'll remember the event. They'll pay attention to the cause. And so you ask this person, why are you this way? Why are you that way? They'll say, I'm this way because this thing happened to me when I was 25, which means I haven't been able to change since I've been 25. In other words, that event now has affected them, that it's become part of their identity. So then, is it possible that the emotion that they feel every single day is keeping certain genes switched on and other genes turned off? More than likely, as long as they keep feeling that emotion. So then let's say to the person, Okay, let's stop telling the story of your past and let's start telling the story of your future. Let's start overcoming the emotions that keep you connected to your past. And we teach them how to do that. So when the person finally overcomes the emotion that keeps them connected to the past and they break free from those chains, now all of a sudden the body is no longer being tormented, believing it's in the same past experience 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. The person all of a sudden, as they overcome the emotion, not the event. The event is incidental because they'll remember the event equal to their ability to reaffirm their need to say, I haven't been able to change because of this event. And memory is creative. 50% of that story isn't even the truth. So they embellish the story to make it more difficult, excusing themselves to not be able to change. When we say, forget the story, just overcome the emotion. When the person overcomes the emotion and they look back at the past, they see that they needed to go through it for whatever experience they needed to go through. And now all of a sudden they no longer belong to the past, they belong to the future. So then they've changed the emotion that's influencing the way they think and act, and that means they're no longer predictable, no longer in their past. And the side effect of that is an instantaneous change in their body. There goes whatever health condition that they've had, because they just turn that gene off for MS and they turn on the new gene for regeneration and health. There's a switch that goes on because the body's no longer reliving the experience emotionally. So we're always amazed in our week-long events when people come onto the stage and they tell their story of how they healed during that week. I never know. I mean, the conditions are so amazing that this person is able to make significant strides and changes in their health just by changing their state of being. It becomes like the 4-minute mile. Now, once you see someone on the stage telling that story and they have some health condition and you look at them and you realize they're not much different than you, then just like an infection spreads amongst the community and creates disease, now health and wellness in that community becomes as infectious as disease. And then once we have that first person break through, then we start seeing dramatic changes all week long.
Nice, terrific. Dr. Joe, no seu livro Você é o Placebo, você traz inúmeros casos de remissão espontânea de várias doenças. Qual o roteiro prático da autocura para que nos tornemos o nosso próprio médico quântico?
Well, this is something, once again, that I spend a lot of time doing my best demystifying. And when we started seeing, Wallace, these very profound changes in people's health during a weekend workshop, that was more than 10 years ago, I saw people step out of wheelchairs and people have spontaneous remissions right during that weekend event. That's when I knew we had to start doing measurements. We had to start studying the brain. We started studying the body. We started studying the immune system, neurotransmitters. We started measuring the energy around people's bodies. We looked at if they can control their autonomic nervous system and could they control how their heart beats and could they have an influence on all these different elements, gene expression, telomere lengths. I wanted to measure everything to be able to understand that there's a formula, a process that can take place with personal change and transformation. And so when I looked at the placebo, by the way, there's no real study that can be done in science right now that's not a triple blind placebo study. In other words, you always have to account for the mind in every single pharmaceutical or drug study. And when I started researching the placebo, I was fascinated by the fact that you could give someone a sugar pill, a saline injection, perform some false surgery or procedure, and a certain percentage of those people will accept, believe, and surrender to the thought that they're getting the actual substance or treatment, and they begin to manufacture the exact pharmacy of chemicals equal to the substance that they think they're taking. Now, the question is, is it the sugar pill or the inert substance? Is the placebo doing the healing? Or is it the body's innate capacity to heal by thought alone? So then, if 80% of people that are in a depression study that are given a placebo respond as well as a person who's giving the actual antidepressant. And you do brain scans on these people that are given a placebo, and you see profound changes in their brain. That change isn't in their mind, it's in their brain. That means that they're making their own pharmacy of antidepressants by thought alone. So then you give someone an aspirin, and it's white and it's round and there's a line through the middle, and they take it, and they notice their pain goes away. The moment they notice their pain go away, they remember what caused it, that little white pill. So they take the pill again the next day, and their pain goes away the next day. And they take the pill the next day, and the inflammation goes down the next day. Then the doctor substitutes, or researcher, just a pill that looks just like that aspirin. But now it's just starch. And when they take the pill, they report that their pain levels go down. So then that pill becomes a symbol of possibility. So if the doctor says, this is a new drug, Wallace, that's going to cause your condition to go down, here's the research, this is what we've studied, and a certain percentage of those people, that pill will be a symbol, and they'll begin to think about them being well. They'll start to select a new potential in the quantum field and see themselves well. Now, that's not enough. That's a clear intention. But the majority of those people will start feeling optimistic. They'll start feeling inspired. They'll start feeling grateful. And they're combining a clear intention with an elevated emotion. And they're changing their state of being by thought alone. Now, here's the question. Do you need the sugar pill to change your state of being? Or can you just, independent of that pill, marry a clear intention with an elevated emotion, select a new potential in the quantum field, embrace the emotion before the event occurs, and every single day change your state of being? Now, here's the key. People are so entitled to think that they've done it once and it should take away their health condition, and they go back to the same identity or the same personality. In the triple-blind placebo studies they did on depression, those people took the placebo for 8 weeks in a row. Every day they took that pill, and every day they thought about that new future. And every day they were changing their state of being. So then if it took 8 weeks for people to heal from depression by taking a sugar pill because they changed their state of being, then it may take 8 weeks for a person to finally change their state of being so that the condition is finally gone. So we've come up with a formula, an understanding that when you combine brain coherence with heart coherence and the interaction between these two profound organs, one has to do with the thought, the other has to do with the feeling, to change a person's state of being and create coherence in both parts, brain and heart. And people do this properly, and they can change their state of being until it's familiar to them. So it's who they are. They've become that person. That's when we see significant changes take place in a person's health or in their life. Now, some people, they're at it every day. Every day they're overcoming themselves, they're overcoming themselves, they're overcoming themselves until they become somebody else. Other people, they come to a week-long event. They have a profound mystical experience. Everything lines up. It was their moment. And that interaction with energy is so profound that energy influencing matter causes an instantaneous change in the person's health. Now, if you asked me a year ago or 2 years ago, if I thought we would see a lot of this, I would say, maybe a few. But now we're actually able to induce it. We're actually able to predict it when it's going to happen. And we're actually able to replicate it. So now we're looking at some scientific principle that says that when a person begins to learn the formula for personal change and transformation, they can produce dramatic changes in their health as well as dramatic changes in their life.
Nice. I would like to do a last question. You have time?
Okay.
Okay. Dr. Joe Dispenza, eu gostaria que você falasse sobre essa atual crise do coronavírus, né? As crises normalmente têm algo a nos ensinar, né? Isso são crises cíclicas e a gente está passando por uma grande crise mundial que conecta o mundo todo em função de um vírus. Como é que você, qual é o seu olhar para esse momento atual e quais são as sugestões que você dá a nível de superação e de aprendizado?
Well, I believe that the body absolutely has an innate capacity to heal. And I think that people, Wallace, that learn the truth about how their body functions will have more empowerment to realize that when they react in fear, we've done the research on this. Do you think fear strengthens your immune system or weakens your immune system? Fear weakens your immune system. It's a scientific fact. So a person who's reacting to all the conditions in their environment in fear, the response to the environment is actually weakening them to all kinds of conditions in their environment, and they'll be more susceptible to viruses and bacteria because their immune system has been downregulated. I mean, if you're living in emergency mode all the time, it's those bacteria, those viruses, bacteria are called opportunistic bacteria because they're waiting for an opportunity for your immune system to be compromised. So then if we're reacting to everyone and everything and the organism, the human body is becoming weaker, then it makes sense then you'll be more susceptible to conditions in your environment. So number one, learn the truth about your body. Does that mean not take the necessary precautions? No. Honor it as it is. But by the same means, don't give your power away to something outside of you. So we have research to show that 4 days of gratitude, just feeling gratitude for 4 days, can strengthen your immune system by 50% to make the exact antibody, the exact immunoglobulin that fights bacteria and viruses in your body. It's better than a flu shot. So then when the person is self-regulating and choosing how they're controlling their inner environment independent of their outer environment, they'll be less sick. And viruses tend to attack people who have pre-morbid health conditions, that are on certain drugs or medications, that are maybe elderly and are fighting a health condition already. The virus preys on people that are already out of physical, chemical, or emotional balance. So then if there's three types of stress, physical, chemical, and emotional, there must be three types of balance, physical, chemical, and emotional. And if people start taking care of themselves physically, whatever that is, taking care of themselves chemically, making the right choices, taking their vitamins, taking zinc, taking vitamin D, forgiving people that in their past that betrayed them so they don't hold on to the emotions that keep their body out of balance, I guarantee you they'll be less prone to infection. They'll be less prone to disease. Now, we are working with universities in the United States, and we have some amazing preliminary data that shows that you can strengthen your immune system so that you are immune to viruses. And that's not something that's new. The human body's been doing that for thousands of years. And so let's learn the truth about our body, whether it's coming from a virus, COVID's coming from a virus that was created in the Wuhan lab, that it's 5G or that it's genetically modified or it's a cross between a bat and a pangolin, whatever your belief is of what it is and where it's come from, you still have a better chance of being immune to that virus by making sure that you know how to self-regulate, to manage your inner world so that you are immune to the challenges and conditions that take place in your outer world.
Very nice. Dr. Joe, thank you very much for this brilliant interview. And I would like to know if you have any plans to come to Brazil so that the Brazilian people can experience your incredible work.
Yes, I want to come to Brazil. I want to come and do a progressive workshop, a Friday night, Saturday, Sunday event. And we have plans with, now that our books are being published in Brazilian Portuguese. We have Brazil as one of our main countries that we want to go to. We've been to South America the last couple of years, and as you know, South Americans are passionate people that are smart and intelligent and open-hearted, and they already have a great balance between their head and their heart, and I would love to come. I actually was scheduled 3 times in the last 10 years to go to Brazil, and each event was canceled. So this time we're going to make sure that we go and make sure that we run a great event. We were in Bogota last year, or is it this year, February of this year, and we had over 3,000 people at that event. So I'd love to come to Brazil.
Nice. It will be a pleasure to receive you here. Would like to let a final message to Brazilian people?
Sure. I mean, listen, I think the most important message is that we already know how to do this. We already know how to do this. And before you wake up every morning and you check your cell phone and your Facebook and your Instagram and your emails and the news and get up and go through your routine, ask yourself, what do I want to create today? Who do I want to be when I open my eyes? Is there a possibility that if I change the way I think and feel, if I begin to combine a clear intention with an elevated emotion and memorize what that emotion feels of my future and then be able to live in the energy of my future, maybe I'll start seeing my life change in some way, because when you change your energy, you change your life. And nobody is so special to be excluded from this phenomenon. In fact, you can't tell me you're too old to do this work. We have people in our community that are great beings that are in their 80s and 90s that live this work. We have children that are 8 years old and 10 years old that come to week-long events and participate. You can't tell me you're too sick to do this work. We have people that are diagnosed with really serious health conditions and told to go home and die, and now they have no evidence of that disease in their body. You can't tell me your past was too hard or too turbulent that you couldn't change. We have people that have had very difficult pasts that are some of the happiest people in the world right now. You can't tell me you've never meditated before, because our research shows that people who haven't meditated sometimes are so innocent that they just follow the instructions and do exactly what you ask them to do, and they produce dramatic effects. So a little time out of our busy lives to practice being a creator. And when you invest in yourself, you invest in your future. And when you believe in yourself, you believe in possibilities. And when you believe in possibilities, you got to believe in yourself. A little time every day when you wake up in the morning or before you go to bed at night to change your state of being and to create from the field instead of from matter. And I can tell you that there are thousands and thousands of people all around the world that are doing this and sowing the seeds of their efforts. And so try it out. See if it works.
Thank you very much, Dr. Joe. I hope that you can come soon to Brazil. I know that you have a very, very hard agenda. And I hope that your work can achieve millions of hearts and minds in the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Wallace.
Bye-bye.